Dr. Kipkoeech Araap Sambu is East Africa's first and only Egyptologist so far. Witness now one of his most memorable pictorial lectures on Egyptology. He has launched a crusade against the ignorance that plagues not only black people, but the people of the world about the history of Egypt. Through his teaching, research, and slideshow, he will replace the colonial engineered ignorance with the true history of ancient Egypt. He will chronicle the earlier knowledge of this unique heritage of the people of Africa. His crusade will teach the teachers and the students, for teachers must be secured in their knowledge to revise the syllabus of old and unmask the rich and proud history of Africa's past. Here in this slideshow, Dr. Sambu answers the dare of one of Kenya's premier universities to demonstrate what his discipline entails. The DVD project is designed to enlighten African academia and academia all over the world to break through the protective cordon that has been thrown around the innocent youth. This current situation will only lead to perpetuating the cycle of ignorance about true African genius. The concepts are explained so that viewers who are less familiar with history and anthropology are taken on board. No one who attended or watched Dr. Sambu's lectures ever left the same.
The fact that we are able to discuss an Egyptological topic at this level before this most intellectually powered black audience is victory for the Africans. It calls for celebration. But in Kenya, we don't have a national victory song. However, they do have it in what became my second home, South Africa, the home of my second alma mater, the University of South Africa, to which country and institution, therefore, this work is dedicated. Shosholoza was sung by miners during their days under apartheid degradation and oppression. It merely says, shove the steam engine all over. Shosholoza stimela. This the miners did as they toiled to load rocks containing minerals of all sorts deep underground onto wagons. But for every victory against apartheid, they sang this song. So much so that it was later adopted as something of a national victory song. Like the famous Negro spirituals, which were sung under similar circumstances, it has an ever-growing appeal. Egyptology as a subject has been historically kept out of the reach of the African learner. It has been considered a subject that was not only non-African, but one that was also irrelevant to the African whose needs were supposedly immediate and more physical and were still related to the day-to-day basics of survival. With the evidence right in front of us now being the norm and not the exception, can we still go on as if ancient Egypt's history is not about the black man? The misconception has happily been perpetuated by generations of educational managers from our own race, this being the successors of departed colonial and former slave masters who set limits in space and time, that is, as to how far in geographical space within the continent of Africa that African learners of African history can venture outside their own country's political boundaries, as to how far back in time the learners of African history can probe in order to understand the present, the future, and the African's potential. Our syllabus inherited menus that specialize in the self-demeaning aspects of African history, such as the time under colonial degradation and slave trade, where the African was the merchandise. We are taught that the African's best day ever was when he freed himself from both vices, that this is all the African should mourn and celebrate respectively. Yes, we have learnt perhaps enough about the time of our capture not to allow ourselves to be so degraded as a race again. We appreciate, and yes, we celebrate the heroism of our liberators from such collective historical discomfitures. However, the fact that there was a time in the past when the African initiated, invented, discovered, and led the way in all aspects of science, technology, and the management of society through politics, religion, and other cultural norms, in short, human civilization, is hidden from the African learner. When confined to learning about his darkest hour and then complete liberation from it and no more, the African learner is subtly being taught to accept the temporary inferior position as historical, innate, inborn, and even deserved. This is a worldwide African problem, and the African-American professor, Asa Grant Hilliard III, a renowned professor of educational psychology, says, "We teach non-culturally responsive curricula that leave our children ignorant of themselves. And by now, it should be clear that, for the most part, our children are geniuses with capacities to go far beyond any current school requirements." End of quote. This then is what, on my part, I think we must do for our children to regain confidence in themselves. We must know where Africa begins and ends. Our educators need to redraw the conceptual map of Africa, which must include ancient Egypt as a socio-cultural integral part. That sadly is not the Africa in the mind of our current educators. Theirs has been an ancient Egypt hived off from its mother continent, dismembered and scattered all over Europe and Asia Minor. But that we can sit down this afternoon and discuss ancient Egypt as an African past, our own history, historically denied us, shows signs of the beginnings of the reinstating of the integrity of Africa and of ancient Egypt as the rightful history and heritage of all Africa in the diaspora and on the continent. It truly calls for that great song from down south as they would do it there. Ladies and gentlemen of this august institution, the intellectual liberation struggle has just begun. Will you now join hands with me in welcoming the inimitable Dan Moyane?
Shosholoza,
shosholoza, ulezontaba stimela kumenzanza Afrika.
Shosholoza,
shosholoza, ulezontaba stimela kumenzanza Afrika.
Most of the material presented here came from a lecture that was delivered to Kenyatta University, Department of History, Archaeology and Political Science on 21st July 2005. It was entitled The Quest to Reclaim a Lost Intellectual Obelisk, looking at ancient Egypt as a truly African historical experience. In this post-recording, I have dropped a few of the old pictures and added others, but I have been careful to retain the theme of the lecture because I think it was a really inspired lecture delivered under the most ideal of circumstances. Here, as during the lecture, I will throw in frequent examples from Kalenjin land, largely owing to clear linguistic affinities between the modern Kalenjin language and the various language stages of Egyptian. However, examples from other African languages and cultures abound and will be thrown in as well where appropriate, because ancient Egypt was a microcosm of Africa and not exclusively Nilotic. Let us now re-emphasize the purpose and objective of this exercise, as it concerns everyone. The purpose and objective of the exposition is to sensitize the African people to the need to learn and to teach about their pivotal contribution to world civilization as we know it. It is then hoped that from such knowledge they will regain pride in, belief in, and pick up confidence in themselves. It is hoped that through such shows, the Africans will recognize their immense creative potential and capacity as demonstrated in such past. It is further hoped then that they will in time be able to recall such attributes that are so long atrophied, put them to use, and transfer such creative culture to posterity. This is a calling for psycho-intellectual rearmament. But as concerns the prospective student of Egyptology, in brief, the exposition sensitizes and draws attention to the need to equip our youth to be able to carry on the work of discovering and rediscovering the African past by empowering them through the teaching of certain literary elements from the discipline of Egyptology alongside other African-centered courses. To them, we will emphasize the need to further empower themselves by acquiring the relevant textual literacy. The structure of the lecture. We have already introduced the topic of this evening and the objective thereof. Now we need to explain the word obelisk, which is an important word in the title. And then we'll launch into a brief illustration of facial and cranial profile recognition. A brief introduction on how to recognize faces on our monuments will put us in good stead to recognize faces of Africans in contradistinction with others, as this is indeed vital for tonight's discussion. Then we launch a brief explanation as to who were the indigenous Egyptians and the later Arabization of Egypt. At that stage, we'll have known for sure that we are dealing with black Africans, and so we'll take a well-deserved break. And when we come back, we move on to world civilization by the Africans, examples of the aspects of civilization that they introduced in art, science, technology, and material culture, which are claimed to be of African origin. After that, we move towards the end of the lecture, and we round off with African influence in the world's religions, and as an extension of the technological discussion, the African leadership in seafaring and marine technology. This then is what we mean by obelisk. This is the oldest stone obelisk extant in the whole wide world. It was hewn for one king called Sesostris I, who reigned between 1918 and 1875 BCE, that is before current era, or BC, or before Christ. King Sesostris, or Pharaoh Sesostris, was of the 12th dynasty. He's actually the founder of that dynasty. So this piece of rock here is 4,000 years old, practically speaking. An obelisk was erected for or by a ruler that his reign may be remembered forever. This is the oldest obelisk, as we say, in place, but the honor of the tallest that Egyptians ever built, or that the Egyptians ever put in place, was the one now in Rome, which was carted away by the Roman rulers, early Roman rulers. It was hewn for Pharaoh Thutmose III, who reigned between 1504 and 1450 BCE. That is about 3,500 years ago. It was originally based at Karnak It is 32 meters tall or 105 feet tall, 2.7 meters wide at the bottom, and it tapers off to about 2 meters at the top. As you can see, this obelisk of Thutmose III now adorns the Church of St. John in Laterano, Rome, Italy. And much as the Christian Church degrades Egyptian religion, referring to it as paganism, they have garlanded this colossal church building with it and surmounted their quote-unquote Holy Cross on it. We come back to the obelisk of Sesostris I and study from up close the inscriptions that we could see from a distance. We must note here that this is a very tough or hard piece of rock indeed, diorite, and it's still a wonder of the world how they were able to engrave 4,000 years ago those neat inscriptions on it using what machinery, because now to engrave on such stone, you need diamond cutting equipment. And those are supposed to be of recent invention. Now, let's come up close and read the inscriptions. This will be your first lesson in a hieroglyphic reading. These are columnar inscriptions, and you read from the top coming down. Number one above is a falcon. This is a falcon, a very special species of bird to the Egyptians indeed. It's called Hor, or Horus, as the Greeks would prefer. For the rest of us, this may even be Hela, representing the god of the storm, which word ends up becoming the name of God in most Semitic languages. But it is still the name for the storm god in Kalenjin. Below it is a rectangular geometrical engraving encompassing what we call the Horus name of the king. So number one and two combine to make the Horus name of the king, and here it reads Ankh, Mosisoth, or the giver of live births. For some reason the king was referred to as the giver of live births. Number three is a bee and a plant of southern Egypt, probably a palm plant, and a bee and some two characters. It reads, according to Western Egyptologists, Nebtawi, of the two lands, or the ruler of the two lands, but probably it should be read Nebautuai, which in Kalenjin still means the ruler of both lands. And number four, the oval-shaped geometric figure is called a katush. It encloses the name of the king, or one of the king's names. And here, let us learn to read the characters. At the top is the sun, called Ra. In between is a beetle, called Hevera or Kobor, and down is a pair of raised hands, Red Ka or Ke, the soul or self. So to read that name, you begin from the middle character, the beetle. The sun character up there is put there for honorific reasons, because it represented God, it had to come first. But you begin reading from the beetle. So the beetle says Kobor or Kever, and the hands Ke or Ka, and the sun Ra. So you read as follows, Kobor Ke Ra. The god Ra manifests himself in this king, that is Sesostris, Kobor Ke Ra. That meaning is retained in the Kalenjin language. Below the oval-shaped katush are two characters, a serpent to the left and a vulture to the right. They are called Nekhbet and Ejo. The serpent is Ejo, the vulture is Nekhbet. And Egyptologists read that combination Nebti, or the two ladies. This is a title that the king went by in many cases. And below is another set of characters similar to the characters in the rectangular geometric figure up there, number two. Here number five reads Ankh Mosisoth, giver of life births, a title that kings went by. Number six is a duck and an egg, or a pictogram of the sun. This is just to say the son of. So Egyptologists would read the sun Ra and then the name of the king, son of so-and-so. But if you combine the two, the duck is pronounced Se. Sera or Sira, son of, or the one given birth to by. If you know Bukusu, Se also means son of. And Ra is also close to the Kalenjin Arab, son of. Or as in many South African languages, Ra means either son of, or Mr., or the Lord. So this king was son of the name given the second cartouche, number 7 below, which reads Userzen, or as we are used to it, Senuoserit. That was the name of King Sesostris. The Greeks have promoted the rendering Sesostris for all the ages, and that's the name that this king popularly goes by. The obelisk culture was not confined to Egypt. Here is one that was hewn from a single rock in Axum, Ethiopia, 1600 years ago. But here it stands not on Ethiopian soil, but on Italian soil at the Piazza di Porta, near the Food and Agricultural Organization of the United Nations building. However, the Ethiopians have managed to claim it back. It's in the process of being brought down, cut up in several chunks, and transported in specially prepared large planes over several trips. It was carted away by the soldiers of Mussolini during what came to be called the Second World War. Ethiopia's quest for its obelisks to come back has succeeded, therefore, and that success has been the inspiration behind the coining of the title of this lecture today. But Egypt, unlike Ethiopia, is not yearning to have its monuments returned. According to the chief of antiquities of Egypt, Zahi Awas, those obelisks serve better Egyptian interests where they are outside Egyptian soil. Dr. Awas may have a point there. Egypt has so much by way of monuments in situ that those ones can only serve as samples that will attract tourists to come to Egypt and view them on native soil. The oldest standing obelisk may be on Egyptian soil, yes, that African mother of the obelisk culture. However, the tallest of the obelisks, the structures that are built for no functional purpose other than for their symbolism, stands on the U.S. soil. This is the imposing George Washington Monument, constructed between 1848 and 1885 CE or AD, that is if you like it, 3,800 to 4,000 years after the original that inspired it, the obelisk of Sesostris at Mataria, Cairo, Egypt. George Washington is called the father of the country, much like our own Jomo Kenyatta being referred to as father of the nation, or Baba Taifa. This 120-year-old obelisk weighs 91,000 tons and sits 55 feet square at the bottom. It is 555 feet tall and no building in Washington, the capital city named for George Washington, and one other whole state, mind you, is named for him, is allowed to come anywhere near that height. It towers magnificently over the entire scenery and is decreed to do so forever. You can see that the Americans were playing with the figure 5, 55 feet wide and 555 feet tall. This monument, in memory of the American Baba wa Taifa, is over 5 times as tall as Egypt's tallest obelisk. But we should not forget that the latter is its prototype, and however high you may go, you will not beat your prototype in originality. That is basic wisdom. Apart from the imposing height, the Americans introduced another piece of innovation. Unlike the Egyptian originals that were hewn from one solid piece of gigantic rock, this obelisk of George Washington is hollow and one can travel up by elevator or stairs to the very top, from where one can view the magnificently, oracularly, artificially planned city. No spontaneity of growth is allowed. From that height, one of the squat buildings viewable is the White House itself. The room at the bottom of the obelisk houses the Egyptianizing statues of George Washington, complete with his Masonic regalia, a form of winged uraeus, or a flying serpent, or a serpent-ringed sun's disk, completes the Egyptian aura around the room. At 555 feet, the Washington Monument was the tallest stone structure the world over for a number of decades. The Eiffel Tower of Paris, France, which is about twice as tall, is mere metal wickerwork. The Washington Monument was even taller than the Egyptian Pyramid of Cheops, which was originally about 478 feet tall, or the Pyramid of Chephren, which stands at its original height of 465 feet. But for nearly 5,000 years, the Pyramid of Cheops had stood as the tallest man-made structure the world over. It is still the most massive, of course, and we'll come to it later on in this lecture. Suffice it to say that this monumental piece of stone structure before us represents, intended or not, tribute to early African ingenuity, which saw the introduction of stone architecture and the technical rules that go with it. Nay, even the word architecture itself, as we shall see later. This massive tall outcrop of a stone structure represents a major intellectual import from Africa. Yet it is only the tip of the iceberg as far as African influence on Western architecture and technology are concerned. Several other stone structures, buildings and towers have since overtaken the Washington Monument as well. An important example is the Canadian National Tower in Toronto, whose height at 1,815 feet is 3.25 times the height of the Washington Monument. However, the Canadian structure is of functional purpose, namely transmission of radio signals, and does not therefore qualify as a monument. In this chapter, we are going to reclaim Egypt for Africa using physical evidence from the monuments that the ancients themselves left behind in great abundance. The ancient Egyptians carved and painted monuments in and on stone and wood, all in their own likeness, and in doing this, they paid attention to the smallest detail and to the particular. Accuracy was not left behind either, and so we have absolute evidence of what they looked like. And it is not what we have been made to believe from Western books, documentaries and films. The majority of those are doctored sources indeed, where even outright forgeries in some extremes have been resorted to. The quest to erase Egypt's African past has spared no effort, and we are going to spare none either in our quest to bring forth the truth. We will bring out to public view monuments that are hidden from them and which are known only to the archaeologists in the field, to museum storekeepers and to the museum curators. We are going to reinterpret those that are on public display, even if most of them have had their noses vandalized. And so, first I need to show you how to recognize faces on monuments. Racist scholars specializing in human measurements, that is anthropometry, and measurements of the skull, that is craniometry, over the last one or two centuries, and such are still practicing their trade even now, mind you, came up with measurements and measuring tools that could provide for scientific classification of races. These were the pioneers of anthropology and ethnology. They churned out statistics that declared that the African was first and foremost prognathic, that is, his jaws projected forward in relation to his forehead. His skull was not broad, but that it was long and narrow when measured front to back. That statistic they called dolichocephalic. The Caucasian was not prognathic, so they observed, and his skull was broad rather than long, so he was brachycephalic. The intentions of those anthropologists and ethnologists may not have ended at the identification stage as there were, and there are still, efforts to link something called group level of intelligence to such physiological differences. These crude-looking measuring tools may no longer be in service, for they have since been replaced by others that are more advanced, more concealed for their purpose. The African's facial profile is indeed prognathic in relation to that of the Caucasian, and who expected them to be the same anyway? And who said that this countenance ought to be considered ugly and the other one handsome, and from whose standpoint? Yes, these two silhouetted men can be identified very easily. The one to the right is African, while the one on the left is Caucasian. And because of African prognathism, if we were to cut off his face perpendicularly from the middle of his forehead in the manner of the white line here, we would cut off a lot of his face. But for the Caucasian on the left, we would cut off only a small part of the face. That is proof of prognathism and the lack of it. African jaws indeed protrude forward in relation to the forehead. But this unmistakable prognathic profile precisely is what the Western scholars are pretending that they don't see on the Egyptian monuments. Here we are going to show an abundance of that, and that was the norm rather than the exception, and that there were only a few exceptions. Thus, the one item of our abuse of yesterday will be our tool of proof today. Indeed, answers and solutions lie where they are least expected. We are going to seek intellectual independence and study our past in our own way, and let us be brave enough to introduce our own methods and tools. provided they are scientific and unchallengeable by any reasonable and intelligent person. When it suited the great African Egyptologist, the late Professor Cheikh Anta Diop, he founded his own laboratory called Radiocarbon Laboratory at the Fundamental Institute of Black Africa in Dakar, Senegal. And here, buried behind some contraptions, is the professor himself. He created his own tools and methods which could measure, for instance, the melanin content on the skins of the mummified pharaohs and other ancient Egyptians. The results from this laboratory enabled Cheikh Anta Diop to conclude that the ancient Egyptians were unquestionably black people, which in any case went to corroborate the Arabic word for such mummified bodies, mumia. After conquering Egypt from the Romans in 641 AD or CE, current era, the Arabs found the preserved bodies, which were so black they called them mumia. The English word mummy comes from Arabic mumia. Such were the black bodies, a truth that comes right in front of whoever cares to find them, such as Egyptologist Dr. Joan Fletcher is doing here. Fletcher believes she has found Queen Nefertiti's body, among others. A lot of hostility, including from the Egyptian management of antiquities and other Western Egyptologists who have preferred emotional and largely groundless reasons why they should reject Dr. Fletcher's findings, has come her way. The Western Egyptologist has never come to terms with these black bodies and prefers to keep them buried with the truth, perhaps. They often cite morality. It is moral to dig until a black body confronts you. So Fletcher had better rebury the bodies she uncovered and look for a Caucasian Nefertiti if she wants to be welcome amongst her peers. Much as I dislike discussing races in the manner cherished by the early anthropologists, ethnologists, and races, guided by the spirit of the late Cheikh Anta Diop, I have introduced the chin-lip line as my own invention. The blue line here and the triangle, I call my approach affirmative action, seeking to counter a long-held denial of right, of heritage, and misrepresentation. So here is how you go about it. Please pay attention to the blue line, this being my own contribution to anthropology. You join the foremost part of the chin and lips with a line and let the line extend upwards and downwards. For the African, you will notice that the line misses the nose and kind of repels the forehead. But for the Caucasian, the line points upwards, almost parallel to the red line here, which is the prognathism measuring line, and cuts through the nose. The size of this angle in degrees tells you who is who on your monuments. Angle A is always held constant at 90 degrees. Angles B and C vary. The closer to 90 degrees that angle B gets, the more Caucasian the subject is likely to be. Equally, the closer to 0 degrees that angle C gets to, the more Caucasian the subject is likely to be. Africans exhibit a more acute angle B, that is a smaller angle, and a larger angle C. With knowledge of such fact, you are undoubtedly ready. You can accurately identify your monuments without exception. Let us now move to the real thing, the practical examples. The man at top left here may look ambiguous until we confirm with our litmus paper test, that is the red and blue lines here. He dates back to the time of the building of the pyramids, that is according to most records, about 4,600 years ago. The head to the right, belonging to Senjem Ibn Mehi, about 4,500 years old, is of wooden carving. It is preserved in the Museum of Fine Arts, Boston, America. He is much less ambiguous and is closer to the norm. The bust of Athena at the bottom exhibits parallel red and blue lines, typical Caucasian. However, exceptional cases of Asiatic-looking or even Western Caucasian-looking busts from ancient Egypt exist, but indeed they are exceptional, few and far between, to the extent that it is plausible to assume that they represented individuals who were of foreign extraction. For instance, what we are seeing here are well-known features of a Hittite, or tongue-in-cheek. Was this Abraham? Well, perhaps not. Our Abraham here is called Hemjunu. He's done in limestone, 4th dynasty. He therefore dates back to the building of the great pyramids. So he's much older than the real Abraham. If you want to see this one, you'll have to go to Hildesheim Museum. However, Africans from anywhere on the continent then and now come in all sorts of facial profiles, but retain other unambiguous African features, such as this prince and princess of 4,600 years ago. They belong to the fourth dynasty, that is the time of the building of the Great Pyramids of Gizeh. Let us now move over to someone infinitely more famous. This is Pharaoh Tutankhamun as a kid. Look how handsome an African child he was. That is before I draw lines all over his face. Even his earlobes are pierced in the manner of East Africa. The blue line repels his forehead and has missed the nose. Typical African. But how so different is a man of consequence to our history, the man later known as Alexander the Great. He conquered Egypt, not from the natives, but from the Persians. So he was, as far as he was concerned, liberating the Africans from Persian rule. He left the quote-unquote liberated Africans under the rule of his generals, the Ptolemies, who ruled Egypt in succession for 300 years. I found this rare bust of Alexander in the British Museum. Now, who can mistake Alexander's portrait for an Egyptian's? We have been looking at wooden or stone monuments that speak the truth to us. Now we'll follow that truth. It's a truth that we all must be prepared to follow unto the grave, and then while there, confront even starker truth. These are the remains of an Egyptian man buried about 5,000 years ago at a place referred to as Nekada 2. The grave is referred to as A303. Please note that the number is upside down, so the man is actually lying on his right-hand side and not on his left-hand side. I scanned this from a negative upside down, therefore you get the impression that the man is lying on his left-hand side. This fetal manner of laying the deceased is common in East Africa among the Kisi, the Kalenjin, and others, that a man must be laid on his right-hand side. And since this is the position that fetuses and babies assume before they are born, it signifies that death is only but a preparation for birth into the next world. However, what is of importance to us here now is the length and narrowness of the skull. It is emphatically dolichocephalic, and you can see that his remains were recovered from more or less the middle belt of Egypt at Nakada, the point circled red on your map to the left. While Seligman was coming out with statistics in East Africa that indicated that the Kalenjin, the Maasai, Teso, etc., that is the Nilotic population of East Africa, were turning out dolichocephalic readings of about 73 to 75% up north in Egypt, archaeologists were uncovering fossils that indicated that those people were also dolichocephalic, returning readings of cephalic indices of between 73 and 75%. That is to say, the width of the average skull was 73% of its length, front to back. Typical African characteristic. So that point was proved indeed. No wonder then that Diop says that the same goes for the skin of the ancient Egyptian. This is the reason why, from prehistory to the Ptolemaic period, the Egyptian mummy has invariably remained black. In other words, during all Egypt's known history, the skin of all Egyptians of all social classes, from pharaoh to fellah, has remained that of authentic blacks. The same goes for their bone structure. That is now Diop, also quoting Carl Richard Lepsius, the German Egyptologist, who said that the Egyptians were from the beginning to the end of history of black skin and of negroid bone structure. Please allow me some indulgence here. I'm proud of the time I spent studying at Humboldt University, Germany, precisely at the institute named for this man, Richard Carl Lepsius, one of the greatest Egyptologists of all time. Like our own professor, Cheikh Anta Diop, truth and honesty were the hallmark of his scholarship, and we'll shortly be revisiting some of his works. I gave a lecture early last December at the Museums of Kenya, Nairobi, sponsored by the Prehistory Club of Kenya. And when I had forgotten completely about that lecture early this year, a woman with a prominent pair of lips ran into me in a Nairobi street, and she came up to me and said, "Daktari, do you remember me? Please remind me. I attended your lecture at the Nairobi Museum, and you made me appreciate my lips. You made me proud of my lips. Thank you." I think she was referring to this princess of Egypt's 18th dynasty, or 3,400 years ago. The head seems to be exaggeratedly elongated, but I think the point is clear. And I think those are not lips to forget in a hurry. Don't you agree with me? We have to that extent concentrated on the viewpoint of the Egyptian sculptor. How about the views of the painter? Let us first pay attention to the picture at the top. Now look at this wonderful painting of human races as seen by Egyptians of 1200 BCE or 3,200 years ago. This is a well-preserved painting from the tomb of Ramesses III of 1200 BCE. And this picture has been acquired from the book by the man we've just heard about, Carl Richard Lipsius. And for this, I thank Ivan van Sertima, who displayed it in the book he edited called Revisiting Egypt. The book by Carl Lipsius is called Denkmale aus Ägypten und Äthiopien, Ergassungsband. This is plate number 48. Lipsius is considered the founder of modern archaeology. He was the first to publish what has been miscalled the Book of the Dead, or in Lipsius' own German, Totenbuch, all because the ancient Egyptians buried their dead with such books of scripture. Otherwise, they were equivalent to Bibles. Now, let us look at the characters here. The first one, number A, is the Egyptian as he saw himself, and he calls himself here Romet, or Romet Kemet, man of the land, or man of the country, or black man. And the second person here, number B here, is a depiction of the Libyan as the Egyptian saw him. He calls him Temho and gives him some light complexion. And number C here is the person he calls Nahasu. This is the African south of Egypt, or south of the Sahara. You can compare number A and C, and you'll realize that the Egyptian saw himself as being similar to the African south of Egypt. Look at the prognathism, as well as even the details of color itself. To the right, number D is an Asiatic person, as seen by the Egyptian of that time. And here it's not clear, but he seems to call him Soti. We may turn to East Africa for an etymology here, and probably that meant Easterners. East is where the sun comes from, and so the calendar up to now refer to the clan whose totem is the sun as Soti. May I draw your attention to the writings, hieroglyphic writings, below this picture? It's read, Poriet Kemet, probably the seed of the land, or the black nation, as translated by Hennisch, the German writer of the big dictionary Gosse's Wörterbuch, 1995. He translates this to Zeth Egyptens, the seed of Egypt, or Schwarze Zeth, the black seed. So indeed, in their self-name, the Egyptians even indicated that they were black. And now let us turn our attention to the lower picture. It is another tomb painting, this time recovered from the walls of the tomb of King Seti I, said to have reigned around 1279 BCE. He was the son of Ramesses I. So this painting is about 3,300 years old, slightly older than the painting above it. It represents another limited depiction of human races. Here the artist has painted the man in front, who represents the Egyptians, brown, and the third man, who represents African south of Egypt, black. It has to be remembered, however, that only a tiny number of Africans are truly jet black, as is shown here. Most of them are indeed of the brown hue, rather similar to the man in front here. Here the artist leaves no ambiguity at all with regard to the pigmentation of the Asian and the European races depicted. We are still with the painter. Here now we go to our third and last tomb. This is the tomb of Chinemotep at Beni Hassan. It's marked number 3, 1,900 years before Christ or before current era. That is, for all practical purposes, 4,000 years ago. Here the artist impresses us with his minute knowledge of his Asian subjects. He had no illusions at all that his compatriots looked like this. But make no mistake, the bright fabrics here were manufactured in Egypt. Only Egypt at this time in the whole wide world had the technology to weave and knit all types of linen. Going by the rule of antecedents, they were the inventors of that technology, no doubt. Now, this is the famous Sphinx of Giza Plateau. It's perhaps the most famous monument after the pyramids themselves. It bears the looks of Pharaoh Chephren, the builder of the second largest pyramid. Now take a look at the prominent lips, the rich full lips, even averted to boot. Take note of the prognathic profile in order to reassure yourself, as if you need to. Indeed, you don't need to. It's so obvious. Climbing on top of it are technicians sent in by Napoleon Bonaparte in 1798 AD, or current era. That's about 200 years ago. This was after he had seized Egypt from the Turkish rule and before he was in turn routed by the British, finally pulling out of Egypt in 1801 AD, or current era. The Sphinx is 20 meters high, therefore they had to use a ladder to get on top and take precise measurement of it. But we must be so grateful to them in that they recorded the condition of this monument at that time, because it has since been denuded by weathering and further destruction. The loss of the nose is attributed to the Mamelukes. It is said that the Mamelukes, the Turkish rulers of the 15th or 16th century, practiced marksmanship on the nose of the Sphinx, shooting it down. And some reports say that parts of that nose are preserved in Britain, but no one is in a hurry to reinstate them. Perhaps we should understand why. That would bring out a very strong African look indeed. Note that his looks as they are now are not clearly African enough, as they must have been originally. In fact, they are. Once again, aren't we so grateful to Napoleon's artist for being so sincere? And so here is how things are today, precisely 1993. Here I'm standing, probably at the spot where the Napoleon Bonaparte's artist sat as he did the sketch that we have just seen 200 years before. To an extent, the basic appearances remain more or less the same. The Sphinx has suffered more denudation from the weather and probably some human interference. However, it has retained its typical African profile, especially the prognathic profile that we learned to identify early in this chapter. To the right of your picture and to my left there is the Great Pyramid of Cheops. We'll discuss that pyramid at length in a following chapter. Here we take a frontal view of the same monument, the Great Sphinx of Gizeh. Behind, to the left of your picture, is the Pyramid of Chephren himself. You may take note of the fact that the casing stone at the very top is intact. However, most of the lower parts have lost their casing stone to the new buildings of Cairo. That squarish, roundish face, doesn't it remind you of somebody from modern Nyanza? A Sphinx once again, just to get used to them. This one bears a likeness of Amenmet II, one of the most important kings from the 12th dynasty. Remember, that dynasty featured such great kings as Sesostris. Amenmet II reigned between 1876 and 1842 BCE or BC. For all practical purposes, 4,000 years ago. Here his nose is broken by people who don't want us to identify them more conclusively, but we'll be catching up with them in the next couple of slides or so. But do note that a Sphinx is a human being depicted in the form of a recumbent lion, such work of art being an accurate representation of the subject. I'm talking about the face, of course. As Africans, we know about totemism. The royal animal, in this sense, the totem of the king, was in most cases the lion, and therefore they loved to have themselves portrayed in this manner. Suffice it now to say that this one is preserved at the Louvre Museum, Paris, France. Here I am showing you the back of a Sphinx for you to compare with the next two slides and make your own conclusion. However, let me give you a hint here. Please take a careful look at his hairstyle. The hairstyle on the Sphinx previously shown were no coincidence. It was a favorite of the general laity and of royalty as well during the times of ancient Egypt. Here we see the backside of Pharaoh Thutmose III. When hair is tied together and formed into a tail like that, it's called a pigtail. Pharaoh Thutmose reigned between 1479 and 1426 BCE, or about 3,500 years ago. That means he was of the 18th dynasty. This bust is preserved in the Berlin Museum, where I did my practicals on assignment from Humboldt University. Still keep that hairstyle in mind as we go to the next slide. Now you know this pig style was a Pan-African style. This is the same style on a Nandi man sketched by Ray Nestor early in the 20th century after the British had conquered Nandi land. This painting is preserved in the Moi University Gallery, donated by the family of the late Ray Nestor. The Maasai are more famous for the pigtail, but that is because they are still practicing that hairstyle. Back to the Berlin Museum, and here we have a top sculptor and wife from Amarna, Egypt, 1355 BCE or BC. That's about 3,400 years ago. Vandals didn't have the excuse to knock off their noses and blame natural physical causes because the two are carved into a niche. However, do note that the man has his wife on his right-hand side, a rare occurrence indeed. In ancient Egyptian monuments, even as it is almost taboo today among the Kalenjin. Now look at the faces. The carving must have been executed accurately, as even the pot belly of the man was portrayed faithfully. Are these not the ordinary familiar faces you see around here? Now here is a stela of Amenemhat II, approximately 4,000 years ago. Stelae are records left in the field where pharaohs, after an exploit in a battlefield, have their exploits inscribed on tablets of rock for their posterity. And who is that posterity but yourselves? If you take a look at Amenemhat here, you'll know that you are that posterity for sure. We all hope that the university will put this discipline on board so that those of you who would like to be first-hand historiographers can have the necessary literacy and access to them. It's recorded here that this was an exploit of the 13th year of his reign. Amenemhat here is carved into a niche, so his nose has not been broken by the Vandals. I have taken him out and enlarged his picture for you to see the African detail on him. Please note that this is the norm with respect to our monuments, and not the exception. The exceptions come with the age of the Ptolemaic Greek rulers, that is after 332 BCE. Now this is the head of Amenemhat facing us with minimal damage on his nose. Can take a look. Even today, I know many Africans that look like this, especially among the Kikuyu. Don't you agree? We are at the Hellenic section of the British Museum, where I found this rare head. Do you remember whose it is? Yes. This time we are face to face with Alexander, the man who was later called Alexander the Great. He is the conqueror of Egypt from the hands of the Persians. With all what we have learned this afternoon, or even from common sense, can you mistake him for an African ancestor? Strictly speaking, are we his posterity, even though we are still suffering from the effects of the history that he created? Even with the nose knocked out, we can still tell the difference, for the difference is so telling. This is Queen Berenice II, who reigned in Egypt between 246 and 222 BCE, that is about 200 years before Jesus Christ was born. She is a descendant of the Ptolemies, the Greek generals that Alexander left behind to rule Egypt for the next 300 years, that is until they were in turn routed by the Romans. Now, this is the sensational Meremptah. He is the son of Ramses II. And reigned between 1213 and 1204 BCE. I stumbled into this statue at the Egyptian Museum in Cairo. Not that there aren't many like this one, but little did I know that I was stumbling into a most important piece of information indeed. This is not only the pharaoh who defeated the sea peoples, the foreign attackers who attacked Egypt by sea, but he claims to have desolated Israel. And his inscription is the only piece of literature left by ancient Egyptians that referred to the nation of Israel or to the people of Israel as a nation. Nowhere else are they mentioned in the hieroglyphics except on the tablet of Meremptah. So then this is the pharaoh that dealt with Moses according to his inscriptions and according to many scholars. We'll come back to that in the next two or three slides. I took this picture and then loved it so much that I blew it up to A3 size and gave it to an artist in South Africa when I was in the University of South Africa. His name is Mashangwa Ku. The huge gallery of the University of South Africa was full of his paintings, so he was a highly recognized painter. Then I instructed Mashangwa Ku to attempt to restore his broken nose and probably the chin. The base of the broken nose is clear, so I asked him to follow the base and come up with a nose that obeys the rest of the features of Meremptah, not to end up with a nose that doesn't match the rest of the face. That way, I thought that he would work backwards and we would come to what would most likely be the original looks of the man. What he came up with is the subject of the next slide, but I must assure you that he swore by it, that if the remaining parts of a man looked like this, then a reconstructed nose for him would look like the one he came up with. Have a look. This is what artist Mashiangwaku came up with. Even now, I didn't believe what I saw until I studied carefully and saw that he had just filled in the missing part of the nose going by the base of the nose, which is very clear from the original photograph. He also repaired the uraeus, the serpent above the forehead of the pharaoh, reinstated his pupils, did a good job on the lips, the nose, chin, and repaired his regal beard as well. You can compare this with the original just below the restored picture of Merimtar. So without doubt, Merimtar indeed must have looked like this. And as arranged, I met Mashiangwaku at the university canteen over lunch. So as he exchanged these pictures with me, guess who comes along? It was my promoter. You call them supervisors here. He was a white man, an Afrikaner to boot. Have it in mind that this was soon after South Africa won back its independence from apartheid government. So Mashiangwaku and I showed him the photograph and the restored version. He seemed to have gotten shocked over this. And then I told him that I was going to include it in my doctoral thesis, for which he told me that he personally had no problem with it, but how about the external examiners? It so happened that I thought to myself, if this is what will fail me, if the restoration of Egypt is what will fail me, let it so be. I was emboldened by the fact that even Cheikh Anta Diop himself submitted such a bold thesis several decades before me, had it rejected at first submission by the French professors, but it was eventually passed with flying colors. And so I included this in the doctoral thesis. Finally, my thesis was of course accepted. The external examiners I came to learn later were one Afrikaner professor from Stellenbosch University and one black Kenyan professor from the University of Nairobi. This is a stele left behind by Merimtar for posterity to have a benefit of knowing the exploits and successes of his reign forever. By the first few characters top left of the monument, he recorded that these events took place during his fifth year of reign, during the third month of Shomu. Shomu translates to summer, and perhaps summer itself comes from Egypt's Shomu through the Sanskrit. The actual stone tablet with the inscriptions is to the right of the picture, while to the left is a facsimile of it, well detailed, accurately copied, although the Afrikaid nature of the characters has been somewhat compromised. For instance, their prognathism has been played down, and now they look somewhat nondescript. I found the one to your left in the book, Fascinating Discoveries from the Biblical World by Scheffler, a South African. I took the picture to the right in Egypt, but was surprised to find a life-size picture of it, all the 7 feet of it, at the entrance to the Museum of Israel. That is in spite of a very ironic fact inscribed somewhere on it, which we are going to turn to very soon. The scene recorded by the artist at the top of the tablet seems to be the event of Merimtar's own succession to power. It's a typical Egyptian twin scenery, where the same god and characters are shown twice. God Amon, here identified with his long double-plumed headdress, stands double at the center to confer on both sides as follows. To the right-hand side, the god Amon seems to be handing over a sickle or a boomerang. I won't be surprised if it's a boomerang, because the boomerang was native to Egypt as it was to Australia. That testifies to African capability in terms of seafaring so many thousands of years ago. Already, Merimtar here has got the staff of priesthood, the crook, interestingly called by the Kalenjin Kirok, that is the item he's holding on his right hand. And to the left side of the recorded scene above, and these split mirror images, mind you, are common on Egyptian scenes on earth and in the afterlife, show Merimtar already with a sickle or boomerang in hand, and now the god Amon is giving him the symbol of power called Heko, so that now he'll be complete in his reign. If that is a sickle rather than a boomerang, then it must signify the conferred role of God of agriculture on earth to Meremtah. Now back to the inscriptions on the tablet. At about the middle of the second line from the bottom are the words Israel, and that is what has given this tablet the name Israel Stela. As we said before, it is the only mention of Israel in the hieroglyphic inscriptions throughout the history of Egypt. Now, the contentious words are these: Israel fecut bon variet. If Israel has been desolated, no more his seed. Israel has been desolated, his seed is no more. I have taken out this and put it under the picture to your right there and circle it in red for your attention. The longer word reads Israel, or sounds here like Israel. And then the next group of characters is fecut or pecut, finished. And then the two characters that follow, bun, is the late Egyptian way of saying no more. And then the last group of characters to the right, complete with a serpent, reed, according to Western Egyptologists, peret if. But if you know Kalenjin, you should be able to read this as pororiet if, or even pororiet up, meaning the nation of. So what we have here is Israel desolated, no more his nation, no more his seed. That seemingly outrageous claim, yet it adorns the gate to the Israeli Museum. Perhaps by mentioning Israel, it gives Israel more of historical context or legitimacy, if you like it, than it takes away from it by contradicting the events according to the record in the book of Exodus. According to those records, of course, Meremtah was drowned together with his chariots, horses, and charioteers. But if Meremtah lived to supervise the inscription of this tablet, then indeed there may be other escapades that are not recorded in the Pentateuch chapter of the Exodus. However, a third angle of explanation exists, and at this high level may be broached. Namely, that if you know the various East African versions of Exodus as bedtime folktales, such as the Kisi or Chege tales, the Kalenjin, the Meru, and especially the Meru Exodus story, then you can appreciate the allegorical essence of the Pentateuch Exodus story rather than grope around for its historicity, as the scriptural literalists, much lower in interpretive talents than yourselves, would wish to go by. Nay, would wish to live by, rather. Now, this is Cleopatra the VII. I have put it here to facilitate the comparison with the similarly noseless Meremtah, the great man we dealt with over the last two or three slides, and you can now appreciate the difference for yourselves. In spite of the common fact of the loss of noses, they are starkly different. She is a descendant of the Greek rulers, the Ptolemies. Cleopatra the VII bears the dubious distinction of being the last of the Greek rulers of Egypt. The rule ended after 300 years in 30 BCE when Augustus Caesar came along and overthrew the rule of Cleopatra and her lover Mark Antony. She is Caucasian, obviously, and in spite of the broken nose, that is very clear indeed. But she is so much identified with Egypt, a fact that has given boost to the misrepresentation of ancient Egypt as a Caucasian society. Now, this is Octavian Augustus Caesar. The man previously called Octavian was renamed Augustus. His nose is intact, and yet we cannot mistake him for an African. This is the man who gave his name to the month of August, perhaps in competition with Julius Caesar before him, the man for whom the month of July is named. Before this, the month of August was called Sextilis. Here he is wearing pharaonic headdress, complete with the uraeus, the serpent above the forehead. Many Caucasian rulers of Egypt often took to donning pharaonic regalia and even adopting Egyptian religion. Octavian overthrew the 300-year Greek rule of Egypt in 30 BCE, as we learned in the previous slide. He put in place Roman rule that lasted almost 700 years, that is until the Arabs, spurred on by the then new faith of Islam, came and overthrew the Romans. That was in the year 641 AD, or current era, that is about 1400 years ago. Then the Arabs imposed Islam and Arabization, a situation that a formerly black African country could not and has few prospects of recovering from. Now, back to Africa proper. We need this shock treatment and relief from the times of Augustus and Cleopatra. This is Hathor Neferotep, relief in limestone. She is of the third dynasty, that is about 4,000 years ago. The Vandals have had no excuse to knock off her nose because this is just relief. She represents the standard look of the Egyptians of her time. This item is preserved in Cairo. She is wearing a splendid wig, preparing you for the next encounter. Take a look. Another beautiful lady, perhaps a musician, as she is holding on to a sistrum. She dates back to the time of Pharaoh Tutankhamun, that is about 3,400 years ago. She is wearing a wig as well. The ancient Egyptians are the inventors of wigs, and they wore them for thousands of years before Christ. In fact, I have a fellow Egyptologist friend whose doctoral work focused on just the wigs of ancient Egypt. Look at the plaiting work. She looks like a modern, young, beautiful African lady just come out of a salon in downtown Nairobi. If you thought your styles were modern, then here is occasion for you to think again. Again, she represents the standard look of the Egyptian of her time and not the exception. If you want to see this lady, you'll have to go to the Louvre Museum in Paris, France. And now, as a famous comedian from this university used to say, we are getting more beautiful. Check who is coming. It is 1370 BCE, or about 3,400 years ago, all of 14 centuries before Christ, and this is Queen Tiye, wife of Pharaoh Amenophis III, sometimes known as Amenhotep III. She is the probable mother or stepmother of Pharaoh Akhenaten, another interesting pharaoh, about whom we'll have a chat later on. This head is preserved in the Berlin Museum of Egyptian Art, where, as you already know, I did my practicals in reading and translating of ancient Egyptian inscriptions. The picture to the right shows you the queen from the side perspective. I have put it there with the intention that you may mentally try with it your newly learned skill of identifying monuments with the chin lip test technique that I invented. Queen Tiye's head is not prominently displayed and most visitors miss it. Instead, another bust of a beautiful lady, or right, indeed of an admittedly non-Egyptian woman. Mark it, non-Egyptian. A bold act of misrepresentation of ancient Egypt, indeed, is used as a virtual emblem of this Egyptian museum in Berlin. So the occasional outsider is bandied about as a representative of the local population of the time. And to come back to common sense, not even one of the exhibits in this Museum of Egyptian Art in Berlin resembles this one. It is not repeated because indeed it is atypical. Virtually all exhibits within this Berlin museum that this woman presides over are typically Egyptian proper, that is African in every sense of the word. Ironically, this queen is the odd man out. Now let us explore it all the same. This is Queen Nefertiti, wife of Pharaoh Akhenaten, who began his reign about 3,350 years ago. That is 1351 BCE. Her ancestry, according to Britannica Encyclopedia, has been traced to Mitanni, up north in Asia Minor. Her original name was Princess Tadukhipa. She was brought to Egypt to marry Pharaoh Amenophis III as a junior wife and to be co-wife to the beautiful Queen Ti. However, as fate would have it, Amenophis died 3 days before the bride arrived, and instead she was married off to the son of the king, his successor, Pharaoh Akhenaten. The bust on the left is the one serving as a virtual emblem of Berlin Museum, while the incomplete bust to the right is preserved in the Egyptian Museum. Some people think that the final one to the left has been reworked, even though it is known that she was no African. If indeed someone mischievously reworked this bust in order to look more Caucasian, then he was a bit careless in his workmanship. He succeeded in filing down the face into a thin Caucasian look, all right? Just cross-check it with the possible look of the original to the right. However, he overlooked, or rather it was impossible, to sand down or rework the ears. So as he thinned the face, he left the ears intact and in their original span. So we end up with ears that have a base so removed and outward, rather removed from the temples like those of a donkey. Just look at the root of the ear just below the edge of the headdress. Let us take another perspective of this controversial bust. This is composite material I've put together from three different museums. Down to the left is the bust of Nefertiti from the Berlin Museum, while facing her to the right is the head of her husband, Pharaoh Akhenaton, from his colossal statue that is preserved in the Cairo Museum, Egypt. The relief at the top is in Brussels Museum, Belgium. It represents Pharaoh Akhenaton to the right and Queen Nefertiti to the left. The pharaoh's relief presentation and his statue below bear complete semblance. You can see that. However, Queen Nefertiti has not been consistently portrayed. According to your earlier training this afternoon on how to identify our monuments, the relief above portrays an African woman, while the bust below portrays a Caucasian woman. There is a distant semblance, though, as to confirm that it was the same person being portrayed. Has the bust, this one bottom left, been reworked and painted? If so, when? Before or after it was sold by an Arab to a German Jewish entrepreneur and archaeologist, James Simon, who kept it for 8 years in his own house before donating it to the museum in 1920. This bust is so Caucasian that even the number one racist Hitler loved it. He once said about it, "I have viewed it and marveled at it many times. Nefertiti continually delights me. The bust is a unique masterpiece, an ornament, a true treasure." Those are the words of Adolf Hitler. And when the Egyptians demanded to have it back from Germany in 1933, Hitler replied to the king of Egypt as follows. "I'm going to build a new Egyptian museum in Berlin. I dream of it. Inside, I will build a chamber crowned by a large dome. In the middle, this wonder, Nefertiti, will be enthroned. I will never relinquish the head of the queen." And so it ended there, and indeed, this queen still occupies a central part in the love of the Germans. Ironically, the wishes of the Führer, Adolf Hitler, are being fulfilled one by one. Ladies and gentlemen, we have seen the point of view of the sculptor, then of the painter. Now, let's see things from the viewpoint of the modern scholar, the modern scribe. One might ask then, how come this Egypt we are talking about as an African country is really, in fact, Arabic to the fullest sense of the word? The fact, of course, is that when we talk of ancient Egypt, we are talking about an Egypt that had seen no Arab yet, an Egypt that had not suffered foreign European influence either, an indigenous black African Egypt that, however, began deteriorating from the 6th century BCE, when it lost its independence permanently to foreigners who began to take turns, first to the Persians, then to the Greeks, then to the Romans, to the Arabs, then to the Turks, and back to the Arabs, which for all practical purposes appears to be forever, because the original indigenous element in the population has since been swamped genetically, religiously, and socially beyond recognition. From the day the Persian king named Cambyses, 600 years before Christ, or what we call modern era, overthrew what we will call for all practical purposes the last African government in Egypt, the African has lost gradually his world leadership, his number one position in the whole wide world and management of things, and his ingenuity, which was unrivaled at the time, began to slip and give way to aping and following others, a situation that, ladies and gentlemen, sadly obtains to date. The following then are two examples recorded by history of how Egypt, a country that was, as we have heard, originally devoid of Arabs, became an Islamic Arab country. Now we get this from a historian, Harris, in the book that he edited, The Legacy of Egypt, in 1971, page 457. And mind you, J.R. Harris is not an African. Unlike Syria and Iraq, Egypt seems to have had no Arab inhabitants before the advent of Islam. Arab colonization began with the conquest and was encouraged by the Umayyad caliphs, notably Hisham, who reigned between 724 and 743 AD, who in 727 AD authorized the planned migration and settlement of several thousand Arabs of the Yemenite tribe of Qais in the Nile Valley. During the 8th and 9th centuries, large numbers of Arab tribesmen, mainly of the Yemenite origin, migrated to Egypt were many of them who were settled on the land. Now let's listen to Seligman in a book written in 1930 called Races of Africa, revised in 1966 by others, page 151 to 152. And neither is Seligman an African. In fact, he was one of the greatest white racist bigots of his time. The great invasion of the 11th century are on quite a different level. That is from the smaller migrant numbers of conquering Arab soldiers of 641 AD and after. Especially does this hold of the migration of the Beni Ilal and kindred tribes, who in 1048 AD were launched by the vizier of the Fatimid Caliph Muntasir against his master's more orthodox vassals in North Africa. Each man was provided with a camel and given a gold piece, the only condition being that he must settle in the West, that is, in Africa. This well exemplifies the process of Arabization in North Africa, and it was to a large extent an eastern and southern reflux from the Hilalian invasion that had most to do with the Arabization of the Nile Valley, and is thus responsible for much of the present-day distribution of the Arab tribes of the Sudan. Now, in another paragraph, he says, the less mixed Arabs are found in the predominantly European north and east, while in the south and west are those people who, although calling themselves Arabs, inhabit areas in which the Negro is or has been dominant and thus carry much Negro blood. According to Seligman in the previous slide, the more you travel southwards, the more the local population exhibited Negroid features. Here we come to Tebes, around the middle belt of Egypt, and to a festive day at El Kurna. These people seem not to appear at all on TV stories featuring Egypt. They don't seem to make news. Unless, of course, you are talking about the late President Anwar Sadat, who seems, by most accounts, to belong to this segment of the modern Egyptian population. When all is said and done anyway, the greater segment of Egyptian population resembles very much our own coastal population, old Mombasa, Malindi, Lamu, etc. And here I feel at home. I feel like I'm in some village, for example. Here to my left, a friend joins me on the outskirts of Cairo, and I feel very much at Mwambao. You very well know how that coastal segment of our population came about. Now, please transport that formula to Egypt, and you can work out the missing factor in the genetic pool of modern Egypt. And here we introduce another scholar, Sir E.A. Wallis Budge, born 1857, died 1934. He was for a whole 30 years the curator of Egyptian and Assyrian antiquities at the British Museum. He was a sometime scholar of Christ College and a scholar at the University of Cambridge, Tyrwhitt, and an expert in Semitic languages, especially Hebrew. He is best known for his numerous translatory works from Coptic, Greek, Arabic, Syriac, Ethiopian, and of course the Egyptian papyri. The most famous papyri, of course, was the Papyrus of Ani and his work on translating what is called the Book of the Dead. Budge's works on Egyptian religion were unique in that he maintained that the religion of Osiris had emerged from an indigenous African people, a position which Sir Flinders Petrie, another notable Egyptologist of that generation, and others regarded as impossible. The lot of Petrie and his colleagues insisted that the entirety of Egyptian culture had been imported by Aryan invaders. But Budge would not budge, and at the end he was knighted for his distinguished contribution to Egyptology and to the British Museum in 1920. So that is Sir Wallis Budge. He gave to the Africans what was due to them. So one time he says about the ancient Egyptian language in his introduction to his two-volume dictionary, the largest Egyptian-English dictionary so far, as follows. The Egyptian language was fundamentally an African language, he says. These are words used to express fundamental relationships and feelings and beliefs which are peculiarly African and are foreign in every particular to Semitic peoples. Mind you that Budge was an expert in Semitic languages, so he knew exactly what he was talking about when he said the ancient Egyptian language was not Semitic. He continues, the primitive home of the people who invented these words lay far to the south of Egypt, far to the south of Egypt. And all that we know of the pre-dynastic Egyptians suggests that it was in the neighborhood of the Great Lakes, probably to the east of them. This is precisely where we are now here in East Africa. He continues, The whole length of the valley of the Nile lay then, as now, open to peoples who dwelt to the west and to the east of it. And there must always have been a mingling of immigrants with its aboriginal inhabitants. In another section of the introduction to that great dictionary, he says, "The comparatively small amount of attention which I have been able to devote to the grammars and vocabularies of some of the languages now spoken in Eastern Sudan has convinced me that they contain much that is useful for the study of the language of the hieroglyphs. The ancient Egyptians were Africans, and they spoke an African language. And the modern peoples of the Eastern Sudan are Africans, and they speak African languages. And there is, in consequence, much in modern Sudani literature which will help the student of ancient Egyptian in his work. A student with necessary leisure can collect a large number of facts of importance for the comparative study of Nilotic languages, both ancient and modern." That was Badge. Ladies and gentlemen, with total humility, I am glad to report that I have studied the Kalenjin language, of which I have intimate native command anyway, studied the ancient Egyptian language, and compared the two Nilotic languages, one modern and the other ancient, just as Badge wished, and actually vindicated Badge 8 years after he wrote those words. Badge, however, continues to receive much lynching from modern Western Egyptologists for allegedly not conforming to conventions of transcription, some of which came after he had written his last work on translation and transliteration, and even after he had passed on. Yet all Egyptologists still rely heavily on Badge's work on the so-called Book of the Dead, and on Ani's papyrus in particular. So, one may be excused if one thought that all the lynching was about Badge's unequivocal declaration of ancient Egypt for Africa. Up to this point, in this chapter then, we have sought to prove that ancient Egypt was all black, all African in every sense of that word, from the viewpoint of the sculptor, of the painter, of the historian scribe, and finally of the philologist, that is the expert on languages of that region, Sir Wallis Badge. So then we have an ancient people who looked like Africans, were black like Africans, were shaped like Africans, spoke an African language. Do we need other measuring parameters, honestly, to prove further that they were African? Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, let the valued remarks that you've heard from Sir Wallis Badge fittingly close this chapter for us. The rest of this chapter continues in Volume 2 DVD, and that comprises Africa's contribution to world civilization by way of geometry, that is the introduction of the measurement of angles and calibrating of angles, assigning them 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 360 degrees, as well as other mathematical applications that the world depends on for construction of buildings and other projects. All those are original African inventions that we'll discuss in that volume. In that volume, we also discuss measurement of time in hours, days, months, and years that is still in force today, and that was introduced, of course, by the ancient Egyptians. We also discuss intricate jewelry designs and manufacture in gold, faience, precious stones, etc., that are still used even today. We'll discuss shipbuilding and seafaring around Africa and beyond, which the ancient Egyptians were able to accomplish when other people in the world, including in the West, were living in caves. Then, of course, Africa's introduction of organized religion as we know it, etc.
Shosholoza.
Shosholoza. Kumen zontaba, stimelas, kumen zanza.
Shosholoza.
Shosholoza. Kumen zontaba, stimelas, kumen zanza. Hey!